Holy Ghost is here tonight to do some convincing. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to convince you of some things. He wants to convince you of the place that Christ Jesus purchased for you to have in Him. He wants to convince you of all the fullness of His glory that He's purposed to be expressed through you. He wants to convince you of the authority that He's given you, of the divine ability that He's given you, of expressions of His own person that are so inexhaustible, all they can be compared to is like rivers coming up out of you. God, the Holy Ghost is here to convince you tonight that no matter how many things would stand against you, no matter how big the fight, you've been given the overcoming power of Christ Jesus. You've been given the overcoming power that's found in the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Jesus. Lord Jesus. Name above every name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we praise you.
Lord, we worship you.
Lord, we thank you that nothing can stop us.
Nothing can defeat us.
No weapon formed against us can be effective. Because we in you, you're in us. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, mighty God. Estekira Mansateli Mikia Katokonia Bananea. Father, approve himself through you and wants to prove himself through you. You must be willing to stand up against the opposition. Adversity is something that comes against everyone. The fiery darts that the wicked one would try to destroy you with, God has given you a shield of faith. Why do you think that the Lord said be strong in his strength and the power of his might? Because you're in the big middle of a gigantic fight. You're not fighting against flesh and blood nor warring against them. Neither can your weapons be of that sort. But God has given you an ability to take into yourself all that he himself possesses, his whole armor. All that he has, and it's not like Saul's armor. It fits perfectly and works perfectly. It is an armor that's far better than a sling and a few stones. Hallelujah. It's the effective means by which God the Father has executed every dimension of his will. And he says that you might have it. If you want to have it, it's yours to have. But you're going to have to be willing to begin to be filled. And you being filled is not going to be a result of you being in doubt and being swayed by the opinions of demon spirits or of men, but being convinced that that which God has spoken and which God has said is yours. And there in that praise and rejoicing, you will be filled. And being filled, you will be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. And being now filled in that glory and might, you now find yourself fully equipped with the whole armor of God. You both sit on Monday, Pokai, Lishipo, Ranan, Boss, Ishiprapo. Ha, Rabo, Frate. The church really needs you. You can be seated. Listen, the church really needs you. You must understand, the church really needs you. Heaven really needs you. The church is the body of Christ. Listen to me, the church, listen to me. It is so hard to flow in the anointing when people are yawning. So far hard to flow in the anointing when people are exhausted and not giving everything to God and sick and diseased sometimes, especially when they're the church, the body of Christ. I have heard so many times, I've heard so many preachers preaching, and even some that Christ Jesus came to and said, there cannot be much of a moving of my spirit among the Pentecostals. there can be a much of a display of my power among those who are filled with the Spirit. No, I'm not kidding you. People are shocked when that is said. You know, I've heard so many of the great ministers that God used back in what we call the healing revival or the latter rain revival that said, listen, if you want the power of God to come and be revealed, make sure that you just focus on the Methodist, the Presbyterian, the Baptist, the Episcopalians, because the demonstration of the power of God will be there. I mean, I know of one great ministry that they sent out these cards and they had two questions on it. Were you healed and are you healed? Did you stay healed? Something like that. It was two questions of that sort. Did you get healed in the meeting and did you stay healed? All of the Pentecostals basically were on the negative side and all of the rest were on the positive side. The Baptist, the Methodist, the Episcopalian, the Presbyterian. Somebody said, why? Because the Pentecostals had already received the power from on high not to even be sick. What's happening now? You guys went to deathly silent. Deathly silent. Just listen to me. God has poured out His Spirit for you to step into a glory and live in it. Amen. Not to get in a prayer line, but to create a prayer line, to form a prayer line, to have the goods, to have the outpouring. Amen. Yeah, a couple of claps. Yes, no, God help us. Man, that's trying to have a move of God among Pentecostals. Hey, listen, dear people, listen, you need to understand how to live in this wonderful life that is in Christ Jesus. Tonight we just want to convince you that you're in Him and He's in you, that He's filled you up with His glory, and that you can now find this place. Because listen, when you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, there ain't nothing left to do but to grow in a greater increase in manifestation of that. Because you've hit it all, man. You hit the jackpot. That's it. All there is from here is growth and maturity. And if you're thinking and looking for something else, and then you're not going to find anything. You're going to be severely disappointed because it's it. It's done. That's all. And the Presbyterians and the Baptists and the Episcopalians, they haven't stepped into that yet. They don't have that. They never stepped into that flow. And so it's easy to get them introduced to the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. It's difficult when God has given you a mission and a purpose to stir up the church to begin to function as the body of Christ, to begin to function as those who reveal the fullness of God, to understand that there is a supply coming from heaven, but you got to connect with the head. There's a supply coming from heaven where God wants to fill you up and cause you to grow and increase with the increase of God so that you can supply something as well. And as you supply that which God has supplied, suddenly the body, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, begins to grow and build itself up in the realms of love. And when we're talking in Ephesians chapter 4 about this growth and the supply of the Spirit that comes from the head, Christ Jesus, so that we may grow and be built up, and I think as the King James says, edify itself in love. What happens, what the maturity that is ultimately witnessed and realized is all the fullness of God. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 23. Because He is the head over the church who is all the fullness of Him that fills all things. You can't be this quiet. You can't be that quiet. It has to be somewhere. No, don't just start doing it because I said to do it. I mean, come on, there's got to be a continual flow and inspiration. God wants you to have that. I mean, I'm so blessed with the church, the abiding place ministry. I'm so blessed with that which you're willing to allow God to do in your life. But you recognize where those things begin to come up against you, where Satan has been able to, as it were, defeat you and to hold you back, is the things that he will try to do to stop you every time God's got a supply to cause you to move forward. And you're going to have to learn how to rise up in the authority of his faith, recognizing what he's done for you. For everything he has commanded, he also supplies the ability to do it. But it's a force of your will. Amen?
Amen.
It's a force of your will. Oh, come on now. You expect me to flow in the anointing? Then you need to start flowing. Come on now. There is a supply. There's something that God, if you're looking to Christ Jesus right now, that he is causing to flow to every member of his, every person, every individual within the body of Christ. There's a manifestation of the Spirit. There is a flow from heaven so that you and I can begin to participate. But you got to connect, because if you don't connect, you're never going to get that which is going to supply the ability for you to grow and to have the increase with the increase of God. Colossians 2:19, Ephesians 4:15, 16. I can stand up here tonight and quote scripture from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21, and it will not make a bit of difference until you get hungry and willing to apply that which God has said. Now, in a greater dimension. I'm not saying by that you're not applying something that God said. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. Something happened. Some moving of God has taken place in your life, otherwise you wouldn't be here. But I'm talking about growing into an unlimited realm of all the fullness of God. I'm talking about giving yourself to a realm called love. I'm talking about giving yourself to what Paul said in Ephesians chapter 3, in verse 16 through 19. Where you're giving yourself, being rooted and grounded in love, you don't give yourself any latitude to be anything else. Listen, when you were born of the Spirit, you were born in righteousness to be shaped in purity. When you were born after the flesh, you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. I'm telling you, the devil did a very good job of teaching people how to criticize and hate folks and dislike people the moment they meet them. But God, the Holy Spirit, has come here to teach us how to love people in the very instant we see them, and not allow criticism or division or strife or complaint or murmuring or accusation or any of those other kinds of envious things or division or any of those evil things called evil speaking to begin to work. All these things where Satan constantly would discourage and constantly condemn and constantly accuse. Don't give yourself too much to doing that, because I'm telling, turn this up. That's what that means. That means turn it up. Give yourselves continually to that which God is doing, and resist and refuse what Satan is doing. And if you're willing to do this, the Lord made it so simple. He that dwells in love dwells in God. I mean, my goodness. Huh? If you want to have perfect love, if you want to understand what it means, I mean, this is the most important thing to God. It's above all other things. The Lord Jesus said, this is my commandment, that you love one another just like I have loved you. And by this all men shall know that you are my disciples. This is the witness that I demand. Amen. And so therefore, guess what? Satan's center of attack is going to be. Just take a wild guess. Yeah. And so why be ignorant anymore to his devices? Why not come to understand that, as God said in Romans, as Paul said, God said by his servant Paul in Romans chapter 5, that the love of God has been poured into us by the Holy Spirit. Why can't we understand that they're very chief evidence of the Holy Ghost, that he's with you and in you, and that you're yielded to him, is love. It's a divine love. It's a love that we're, listen to me. Come on now, listen to me. Imagine that you're here. Imagine that you're standing here in this place wanting to talk on behalf of God, and that you've got all these folks around you distracted with babies and other interests and nodding off. I used to have some relatives. They're not here anymore. They've gone to be with the Lord. They would go to church, and as soon as the preacher started preaching, they would nod off without fail. They loved the Lord in every way that they knew. They served God in everything that they understood. But as soon as the preaching started, without fail, it was time to sleep. They're a bunch of hardworking people. Guess what happened with their life? They never did much in the kingdom. They never grew. They never matured. They were just stuck. You can get stuck in an offense. You can get stuck in a disappointment. You can get stuck in hurt. You can get stuck in unforgiveness. You can get stuck over some silly little nothing that someone else did to you and miss out on all the dimensions of divine glory. You can get stuck in some little thing that someone said about you and miss out living in the fullness of joy, miss out living in peace that passes understanding, miss out on all the glory of a life that is, the only way we can describe it is that it's the very life of God. It's the life of Christ Jesus. It's the life of the Holy Ghost. It's the life of heaven. You've been seated in heaven, and it's about time that you start believing it. You wake up in the morning, you just don't say, oh my goodness, everything's going bad for me. Everything's challenging. Hey, listen, tonight, Dwayne Lindstrom, I'm telling you, God's got some good news for you. I'm telling you, listen to me, the financial harassments in your life, the things that have strapped you with poverty, the things that have strapped you from moving forward and increasing, listen, they're broken off your life tonight, because I'm coming, listen, the Lord led me to see it, and when you get to see something, you come at it and you destroy it. Huh? I mean, the Word of God is a sword. Listen to me. You listen to me. The Word of God is a sword. It is a sword. And that's not for putting butter on bread. That is, it's a sword. It's for taking heads. It's for killing stuff. And the things we are geared to kill and to destroy are the works of the devil. Jesus was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. If you don't know where that scripture is 1 John 3:7. And if I happen to quote a scripture tonight that you don't recognize, just see me and I'll make sure that you get it. Rewind the tape and get your little computer out. And I guarantee you, do a word search, you'll find it more. Hallelujah. Because we're just filled with the Word. See, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. The way that you think is what's going on in your heart. And God has placed his Word and made of his Word available to you so that you, his Word might be near unto you in your heart and in your mouth. And if you start living out the salvation that he's given you, then the Word of faith that produces, that creates, that agrees with God so the miracle can work will be that which issues out of your mouth, and all that complaint has been cursing you and all those lies that have been holding you in a prison that you've been willing to speak and agree with, it'll come to an end.
Amen.
Tonight, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know, I tell you right now, I'm blessed by the simplest little bit of activity that looks like unity. For example, when everybody says amen at the same time, when everybody sings at the same time, when everybody claps at the same time, I'm thinking we're having revival. Because it's so much so that people have turned to their own way, doing their own thing. Everybody wants to be an individual. What's that? Tell me, what is that? Because all you are is you've been dyed and cast by your culture. You've been dyed and cast by the realms of sociology that you've been exposed to. And it's about time you step over into the realms of heaven and become that one who's fashioned and formed after the Spirit of the living God. Your conversation is there. Your activity is there. You stand in the place where Christ Jesus stands. You sit in the place where Christ Jesus sits. You walk in the place where Christ Jesus walks. You stand in the place where the Holy Ghost stands. You sit in the place where the Holy Ghost sits. You walk in the place that the Holy Ghost walks. You stand in the place where Father stands. You sit in the place where Father sits. You walk in the place where Father walks. You no longer stand in the way of sinners and sit in the seat of the scornful, nor walk in the counsel of the ungodly. So many people, what they believe about life has been counseled to them directly from those who are demon possessed, who do not know God. There's so many of the influences people have had are those that are around them that only what they got high off, what really made them feel good, the only topic of conversation that they ever could come up with and begin to interact with people personally was to be sitting around talking trash about somebody seated in the seat of the scornful. You'll never grow there. Because every dimension of increase and every dimension of growth that God describes is all about you and I being rooted and grounded and settled in love. It's about you and I knowing the love of Christ and there knowing that love. There, first and foremost, being rooted and grounded in that love like a tree, an oak tree planted by the water. I shall not be moved kind of rooted, hallelujah, and grounded. Where there is no latitude to have anything other than the God kind of love, the Jesus kind of love, not the human kind of love. The same kind of love that Boaz sends on the tree. The same kind of love that was commended towards us. That he gave his love and died for us in our place and on our behalf. Commended his love towards us. That kind of love. That's kind of love that Father wants us to have in an interaction, in a connectivity with one another. Because if we're not connected with one another, we cannot receive that which is being supplied by the head. that will result in our growth and our increase and our maturity. And I'm going to tell you right now, I'm talking about increase that far surpasses you monetizing in some financial something or other. I'm talking about the true riches. I'm talking about the spiritual riches. I'm talking about all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. I'm talking about that which Christ Jesus had before he became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. I'm talking about that kind. I'm talking about an increase. I'm talking about an increase in context to what Paul was saying in Ephesians chapter 4. He's talking about coming into the fullness of the measure, of the maturity, of the ministry of Jesus. Amen. Even unto a fully matured man. He gets to verse 15 and he says that you may grow up into him into all things. If anybody didn't understand verse 13, you got it now because he's underlining it. Verse 15, that you may grow up into him in all things. And it's all on the basis of love. It's all on the basis of being consecrated to not allowing any other kind of reactions, not allowing any other kind of behavior, not allowing any other kind of attitude. If you see somebody you don't like, rebuke that in the name of Jesus and yield to the Holy Ghost and start loving them right there on the spot. If all of a sudden imaginations and thoughts begin to bombard you of how God doesn't care about you and doesn't love you, rise up and in the name of Jesus Christ, tell Satan to get out in Jesus' name and begin to yield yourself in a different dimension to that which God has said. Come live under the Word of God. Come let the Word of God rule you. It's time to be mastered by Jesus Christ. It's time now to be ruled by the Holy Ghost. It's time now to be governed by the Word of God. It's time now to walk in the Spirit and live in the Spirit and recognize, people, that you're going to have every kind of tormenting, harassing, intimidating, condemning thing that Satan can throw at you to try to stop you. It's just you're going to have to let God's word be bigger than the word of Satan. You're going to have to let the truth be bigger than the lie. Someplace, sometime, you're going to have to make up your mind that what God said is true and get sold out to it. And no matter what comes at you, you not believe in it. You're not agreeing with it. You're not buying into it. Oh, yeah. The Lord wants you to come to know yourself after what he described, after what he created when he made you a new creation. He wants you to recognize that you are in Christ, that you no longer live, that the old you, the you that was born of your parents, doesn't even exist anymore. My wife just celebrated her birthday. Tell them about it, baby.
November 11th, 1980.
November 11th. I mean, it was a big day. Just happened. What time did you get transformed by the power of God?
About 7 o'clock on a Tuesday.
How old are you now?
35 years old.
Hallelujah. It's a moment in time, an event that is so important. There's not a lot of people anymore that celebrate the new birth. They just got it all in mixed up with the being born of the flesh. Jesus said, that which is of flesh is flesh and cannot come into the realms of glory. He says to the most righteous man alive, Nicodemus, if you would, a man who is the ruler of the Jews, you cannot enter into the kingdom of God until you're born again. That should be the biggest event of our life.
Amen.
There has to be a demarcation of when you died and Christ began to live. And that's not something that's performance-based. That's a miracle work of grace. That which God provided for us as a gift. I had a guy, two different people along the way in my life who, you know, asked me various different questions or made comments about how somehow, you know, one day we'll step into all that Christ Jesus has purposed us to be and he will begin to be revealed in our life. Listen, hold on. That came to you as a free gift. And now that you've received it as a free gift, you no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. You get to grow. You get to mature. You get to grow up into him, into all things. Say, into him.
Into all things.
I get to grow up into everything that Christ Jesus is because he's supplying something through the connection that has been made available to me through this wonderful work of grace where now I am one with him. I'm connected with him. I'm not going to let anything make me other. God's not going to be some transcendent other to me. He's not going to be something other than I am. When Father has given to us by his own grace oneness with himself, listen to me. Here is how your love can be made perfect tonight. Here's how your love can be made complete tonight. Here's how you can step into a realm where you have authority over every lie that comes against you, to know and believe the love that God has for you. That's the biggest battle. The biggest battle of your life, because you got a condemning, liar, accusing, guilt provider running around browbeating you and telling you not worthy of nothing, you ugly too. And anything, any other trash words he can throw at you. And it's about time you get a hold of a shield of faith. It's about time you get a hold of something in divine grace. It's about time you get a hold of the word of God, the word of life, this living, powerful word that's sharper than any two-edged sword, that is spirit and life, that is more powerful than anything in existence and anything in creation. It's easy for all creation to pass away. Easier. I mean, just imagine what it would take to blow up the universe. I was talking to a guy, a NASA scientist, not too long ago, and I asked him, I said, so how far away? He's part of the Hubble and all the other telescopes blasted out into the universe and into our solar system, forgive me. And I said, how close are you to being able to observe the event? He said, we're about 5 years away. I said, let me tell you right now, you've heard it here, don't forget. When you think you can see it, it won't be there. All there's going to be is more expanse. You're going to have to multiply that 100,000 galaxies by another 100,000. And then when you think you're about to polish your lens and you're about to create a greater sensitivity for your photomultiplier tube, you're going to discover that it still goes on and extends further and further and further, because it reflects the eternity of God. I guarantee you, listen to me right now, if science had time, they would discover that everything that God has said is true. You and I, they don't have that much time, but you and I right now have the privilege of having the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him right now, that the eyes of our understanding can be opened, that we may be able to comprehend that which he has spoken is absolutely true. And when we agree with him, the miracle results become a living reality in our life. And until we agree, that miracle results never becomes a living reality. It's always elusive. It's rainbow Christianity. Somebody say, what's that? It's what we played when we were little kids, always trying to get to the end of the rainbow because there's a pot of gold there. And as soon as you think you're close, it just gets that much further away. You never can catch up with it. It's just always, it's elusive. It's always just out of your reach. I discovered one day I can create the rainbow and I can find the end. I found the end of the rainbow. I spotted it. I made it with a hose. I put the hose up. Hallelujah. The little guy. And I got the rainbow. There it is. I put my toe on the thing and I got the shovel. And dug a little bit and recognized there's nothing to that lie. I was a little child, easily deceived by the lies and the trick and the fantasies of men. And that's where people end up at. That's what Paul gives. He gives a choice in Ephesians chapter 4. He says you can either come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, or you're going to be like little children, constantly being tricked and deceived. Always being left out, always missing out, always finding yourself just short of all that God has provided. Somehow, somehow it's elusive. Somehow you can't have it. Somehow the flow isn't there. Somehow you're lacking that supply that God has freely given. And then the enemy tries to make all these various different lies about you, how everybody else is saved but you, how that God loves everybody else but you, how that somehow you blasphemed against the Holy Spirit, how that you, all these lies, and begin to then draw the value of who you are and the value of yourself based upon what people say, based upon who likes you or who doesn't like you, and all becomes mitigated. Who you are becomes something. It's interpreted by everybody else's opinion, and God's left out of the picture. Would you shut that program down? Would you shoot that pony? I'm telling you, it's a one-trick pony. One trick's all that he can do is lie to you. Shoot the pony. okay? You just stop the thing. Stop the merry-go-round. It's a sad go-round anyways. Jump off and start walking with God. Start following him. Hallelujah. Anna's upset I was going to shoot the pony. I mean, it's the wrong, different one. Different one. Tonight we're going to have communion here in a little bit, and we're going to partake of those elements that represent what Christ Jesus gave to us his whole life. And I'm telling you right now, praise God for the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all sin. But the blood of Jesus Christ is more than just a cleansing from sin. It's the impartation of the life of God. Somebody said, I've been cleansed from sin. Well, then if you've been cleansed from sin, the life of God has been imparted to you. It is said, which has purified us and made us holy and acceptable unto God, so that we can now have our lives lived out as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, because he is supplying to us all the holiness that we could ever use and that we could ever need. He gives us his own holiness. It's a gift. You know, because the reality of it is when we're speaking the truth in love, when we're speaking the truth in love and we're holding forth this love of God, and I'm going to just tell you right now, it's speaking out of the word of God by the Spirit. It's speaking the words of God by the Spirit. Then it's there in that place that we're holding forth the head, Christ Jesus, from which every joint and every member, every ligament, every part of the being, every part of our being is supplied with that which only Christ Jesus can supply, that results in our growth and that results in our increase. It results in our maturity. It results in our ability to yield to the Holy Spirit, even in a deeper way, so that the manifestation of the Holy Spirit may be being seen through us. Because if the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be that which he's purposed it to be, the church is going to be expressing all of his fullness. We're going to grow there. And the only way we're going to ever grow there is to step into a fellowship where we recognize, number one, that we have a love relationship with him that is unbroken and unbreachable, that he's in us and we're in him, that we're one with him, that he's one with us. I mean, think about John 17 for just a minute. I love meditating on these verses of scripture, because the Lord Jesus says, Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them, so that they can be one with us. Now, I'm not different from God. You're not different from God. He's made us one with them. I mean, he's still God. We bow before him. He's God and will always be God. And we're the ones who are redeemed. But nonetheless, he made us one with him. And I know it's an unspeakable gift. I know. Hey, listen, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when we see him, we shall be like him. And everybody who has this hope purifies himself even as he is pure. And if you don't know where that is, that's 1 John chapter 3 and verses 1 through 4. I just quoted the larger part of it. This is what he's done for us. He's come and made us his temple where he lives and dwells. I mean, come on, think about it. Think about it. You're never going to have a river till you start saying you got one. Till you start agreeing with God, it's yours. You're never going to be filled with the Holy Ghost and be continually filled with the Spirit till you start thanking God that you are now filled with the Spirit and he's there to supply more. And that's not going to be happening if you're bound up with unforgiveness. If you're bound up with an offense, if you're bound up with a bad opinion about someone, you're living out a hurt. Someone, you know, hurt you, or some problem has now dominated your mind and your thinking. I don't have any problems. I probably am assaulted by the powers of darkness more than you are, but I don't have any problems because I live in the solution. Hallelujah. I live in the problem solver. Why? I made all the problems that Satan can create irrelevant to me. It doesn't matter. It doesn't count. All the problems that Satan can create has to do with my earthly temporal existence. And I don't look on that which is seen. I look on that which is unseen. I don't respond to that which is seen. That's all temporal stuff. Hallelujah. What matters to me, Jesus? Well, what if you were did not have any money in the bank account tomorrow morning? Wouldn't change anything about the way I feel. I don't think I have any money in the bank account now anyways. I don't need money in the bank account. I'm living in the true riches. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm living the riches that Jesus had before he became poor for our sake. I'm telling you, there's no money. There was no Benjamin Franklin's or Thomas Jefferson's or George Washington's or anything else in heaven. There is not a monetary-based system. Hallelujah. It's a generous supply of the one who has and owns everything, continuously fulfilling all that we have need of, providing all that we have need of. It's a wonderful thing when you come to a place where Jesus Christ is your Savior. It's a wonderful thing when you come to a place where He is your provider. It's a wonderful thing when you come to a place where He is also your perfecter. It's a wonderful thing when you come to a place where He's your protector, because now your life is in His hand. You are safe in the bed as you're on the battlefield. I mean, my goodness, think about it. Just think about it. Because reality is, for you to live is Christ Jesus, and for you to die is to be in heaven. And so, and He is absolute God. He is absolutely God. He's sovereign God. And so He decides when you die, and He decides how well you live. And He's supplying you and I ability to live an abundant life, to live the life of God, to live His life, the life of Jesus, to live the life of the Spirit, to live the heavenly life. When somebody says we're going to church, I get so happy. I love church. Why? Because it's like heaven to me. The expressions of the Holy Ghost that take place in the midst of the church that are being supplied to us by the Holy Ghost if we're simply yielded. But we could be in prison to the problem, because we can make the issues of our earthly existence and our temporal existence significant, even more significant than who Father is and what He said. We can actually exalt things above Him. I watch people exalt themselves above Jesus Christ all the time. Here's what happens. They failed. They had some shortcoming, some sin in their life, and they're standing there in the presence of Jesus, and they can't worship Him because they failed. They can't praise Him or lift up their head because they let Him down. That's exalting yourself above Him. You need to make Jesus bigger than you. You need to make His grace bigger than your failings. Hallelujah. You need to make His mercy bigger than all your sin. You need to make all your shortcomings. God needs to be God. God had an idea. He said, I tell you what, if you'll agree with me, I'll be your God and you'll be my people. Hallelujah. Why don't you agree with that? Instead of trying to convince God, oh God, would you please be my God? I so want to be your people. Ha, 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 ha. The unbelief prayer, the agonizing prayer. Come on, people. Whew. Just go ahead and accept the unspeakable gift. Just go ahead and receive the mercy of God. Just go ahead and take hold of the life that flowed out of Emmanuel's veins as He hung there upon a tree called Calvary one day. And there He bore our sins in His own body, that we now being made dead and cut off to sin might live under righteousness, by whose wound we were healed. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. And you don't have to go back to all the way back to Isaiah chapter 53 to find that one. You can get it in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. And I pray in Jesus' name that you already knew that. You didn't need me to quote that. Huh? I'm about to stare at you. I know people that they really believe they love God, and they can quote whole plays by Shakespeare, and they can barely get a couple of verses of Scripture out of their memory. Something wrong with that. Somebody said to me, some major preacher said to me not too long ago, said, I believe some major events happened in your life because you really do have a renewed mind. I said, well, you know what? It's really not that major. It's just a simple gift of God that has been given to us in Christ Jesus, and I love His word, and so I've given myself to His word, and I just speak His word. I love His word. I read His word. I do His word. I memorize His word. Hallelujah. His word is spirit and life to me. It's easier to blow up the universe than for one jot or tittle to fail till every bit of it comes to pass. And start reading about what Jesus says is supposed to come to pass in the midst of His church. What He says is supposed to come to pass even in the individual believer's life. These works which I do shall you do also in greater works. And somebody can't say that was the early first century church, that was just the apostles, 12 of them, because they were ultimately ended up more than that. It was, listen to me, because Stephen wasn't an apostle and Philip wasn't an apostle. He said, anyone who believes. He was talking on the same basis to a general population of anybody who would call upon the name of the Lord. Yes. Whosoever. Come on, man. I got to dance a little bit. I got to dance. Because He feels my emotions. Huh? I don't get all high on the stuff that everybody else is high on in the world. I don't get excited. I'm actually depressed and grieved when I hear a comedian start running all of his lies down. Everybody else is rolling on the ground laughing. I only roll on the ground laughing under the power of the Holy Ghost by being thrilled by the working of the Spirit of the living God. I'm strange and of a different sort. I don't belong to this world. I've been born right out of the realms of heaven. I'm not of this world, even as he's not of this world. I'm not of this world, and I don't have a bumper sticker, not of this world. I'm really not of this world. I've been born of the Spirit. I've been born of the Word. I've been born of the resurrection. God's inviting you to come on in. Sell out to the light that God has for you. Sell out to this abundant life that he has for you. It's about time to live in the liberty, the glorious liberty of the sons of God. It's about time to live in the authority. Hallelujah. Of anyone who believes, he gave them the authority to be the sons of God. It's about time to live in a disease-free zone. It's about time to live in a sickness-free zone. It's about time to live in a sin-free zone. Somebody said, how can you do that? Being captivated, raptured, caught away in the glory of heaven. Being lit, coming into the holies of holies by the blood of Jesus Christ and not leaving. I just don't believe that you can begin to see something more than Isaiah saw in Isaiah chapter 6 and then go back out and carouse with demon spirits. And be entertained by all the stuff that's flooding out of hell and that the servants of darkness, the children of the devil, has captivated with their skill sets taught to them by the powers of darkness and made movies out of them so that you can sit there and drink of that bitter water and expect sweet water to come pouring out of a fountain. You can't take fire into your bosom and not be burned. You can't fellowship with devils and still have a flow of the Holy Ghost, sweet and divine, that God has ordained. You're going to have to decide whose side you're on. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Being born of the Spirit is the most wonderful and most glorious event that could possibly happen to any human being. And it's supposed to result in you stepping into a relationship, into an interaction with the kingdom of God, that which Christ Jesus is king of. An interaction with Jesus himself, with the Holy Ghost himself, with the Father himself. Jesus said, come and ask the Father. He loves you. You don't have to ask it only me. You can now go down to the Father and ask in my name. Whatever you ask the Father in my name, he'll do it. People, it's a love relationship, it's a fellowship, it's a growth, it's a maturing. You don't need to get stuck in the offense. You don't need to get stuck in unforgiveness. You don't need to get stuck in all the problems. You don't need to get stuck in all of the lies that have been taught to you. You can believe the truth and begin to live out a glorious life. You can believe the truth and it will liberate you. You can walk in the glorious liberty of the sons of God. You can walk in the glorious liberty of the Holy Spirit. You can walk in the true freedom that exists. We're no longer the taskmaster, Satan himself, who would rule over you with his tyranny and demand that you believe a lie and be damned. You can be free from all of that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And live in the good things all day long and not have imposed upon you the bad things. So I said, oh, we're just all, you know, we have the right to choose and each person chooses what they want to choose. You're not choosing nothing. You get an opportunity to choose Christ Jesus and be liberated. Otherwise, you under the tyranny of a taskmaster called Satan. I'll prove it to you. How many people choose to be sad and tormented? How many people choose to be afflicted and sick and diseased? How many people choose to be poverty-stricken, oppressed, and beaten? Nobody chooses that. It's imposed on you. It's imposed on you. And Stalin brought his generals around, and one day he said, this is how you rule men. And he grabbed a hold of the chicken, and he plucked all the feathers out of the chicken right there in front of him, just ripped the feathers out, blood feathers flying everywhere. The poor chicken is there, stark naked, not a feather left on him. And what did the feather do? What did the chicken do? The chicken crawled up to his boot. He says, that's how you subjugate. Satan taught him firsthand. That's how you rule men. Think about that. Who wants to live under that thing? Every tyrant from Nimrod to the present day that you could is recorded in history. All they were was just a small childlike manifestation of the satanic power of who Satan is. They were taught by their father, the devil. who wants to live in that realm. Father has come to set us free so that we can live in the glorious liberty. Father, who shall proclaim? Father has come to set us free so that sorrow and sighing has to flee away. The redeemed of the Lord has returned and come with singing unto Zion, and everlasting joy is upon their head. They have obtained gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing has fled away. Somebody said, how can you remember all of a Bible like that? Because I live it. Because the Spirit of the living God who gave it lives on the inside of me. He brings it to my remembrance all things which Jesus has spoken. And I'm telling you right now, it's the power of God working mightily in me. His word works effectually in me. It's an explosive dynamite power from on heaven that's exploding on the inside of my passions, on the inside of my emotions. Jesus chose a very specific word. Jesus chose a very specific word that ultimately came to us, and the Greek word kolia, which in Attic Greek refers to the explosions of the passions, to the human passions unrestrained. He used this word, this wild word, kolia. And he said, out of your kolia shall flow rivers of living water, the spekia, the Holy Ghost. He could have used heart. He could have used all these other different various phrases that most men would be, especially that have been impacted by Aristotle or Socrates or Plato, that they would demand you speak or believe about the dichotomization of man. No, he could have used spirit. No, he used kolia, your passions, your emotions. Oh, doesn't that fly in the face of the doctrine, the doctrinal stuff that has come down through supposedly church fathers of the 4th and 5th century that has held men in prison because all Thomas Aquinas did was take Aristotle and put it to Christianese. All they were was philosophers who amalgamated the word of God with the things which Aristotle and Socrates and Plato and Philo taught. I'm telling you, I'm not interested in all those doctrines, men. I'm interested in what God has said. I'm interested in the word that he's delivered unto us. I'm interested in the Holy Ghost that wants to work mightily in us. I'm interested in seeing the evidence of that which God described should be happening in our life. And I'm going to tell you right now, everything the Father's purpose for us to be, he supplies it to us. However, we got to be connected. However, we got to agree with him. Agreeing with him is being connected. Listen, the Lord brings it down this way. He said, if you're not connected with those that are around you, then the supply can't flow to you. So you can't be, God wants you to give out of the supply that he gives, a supply. You and I can only grow according to that which Paul said. And of course, there's many other verses of scripture, not just Ephesians chapter 4, verses 15 through 16, not just Colossians 2:19, which is a corollary verse of scripture to this, but many verses of scripture. We're not going to grow and we're not going to increase unless we are receiving something that only he can give. And he's not withholding it or restraining it from anyone. It's just that we do not connect with him. We're not willing to agree with him. We're not willing to submit to his divine order. We're not willing to go with a kind of love that he's purposed for us to have. We know that we've passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. How do we love them? We love them just like he loved us. If he loved us and gave himself for us, how much more should we lay down our life for the brethren? Hallelujah. People always just getting offended, upset. Some people harbor offense, harbor some kind of, problem in their life that is a hearsay problem. They heard from somebody else that somebody did something. She said that they said. And that holds them in prison and keeps them from ever moving forward with God because they harbor an offense, they harbor a criticism, they harbor a dishonor, a disrespect towards one of God's people. And they're not. Now they're out of joint. Huh? Now they're disconnected from the body. Tonight we're going to partake of that which has supplied us with the very life of God, with the very provision of God, the life of the Holy Spirit, the life of the Father, the life of Jesus has given to us all the provision, all the riches of heaven. We're going to partake of that. And the Lord says we need to make sure that we understand what we're doing, that we don't eat and drink damnation to ourselves. It'd be terrible. Somebody's standing around in the meeting shouting, praising God. And then because they don't discern the body of Christ and eat and drink this wonderful fellowship and communion in an unworthy way, they eat and drink damnation. You don't have to worry about that. You in Christ Jesus, aren't you? You don't have to get all big saucer-eyed on me. It's okay to have the fear of God in your life, but you don't need to get all saucer-eyed on me. You can be just confident that everything's right with God. And that if you have any unforgiveness in your heart, you just get rid of it right now, because the Father will forgive you as much as you have need of. I heard one preacher say he did the math. He got his calculator out, and Jesus said that you're supposed to forgive, and if you forgive, God forgive you 7 times 70. He figured that must be 490 divided that by the total minute of seconds of the day, the total number of seconds of the day he had, how many times God's going to forgive you. That's not what it means. It doesn't mean that. It means that he's going to forgive you as much as you need to be forgiven. If you're willing to forgive. That's just the mercy and the grace of God. You can't miss out on God's goodness. You can't get out of God's love. I'm telling you, nothing can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Nothing except for you. You can decide you don't want to participate. You can decide you don't want to cooperate with God. You can decide you don't want to obey him. You can decide you don't want to be taught of God. You can decide you don't want to be taught righteousness and holiness, that you just like unrighteousness and wickedness. You can decide that. I wouldn't do that. The choice is yours. You can either fellowship with demon spirits, or you can just fellowship with the Holy Spirit. You can hang out with the devil who hates you, or Christ Jesus who loves you. You decide. You can hang out in hell or heaven. Which one you want? Yeah. People go, I don't believe in God. Loving God would send me to hell. Listen, your choice has got you in hell right now. Many people, I'm not talking to necessarily anybody in this place, but be you, but look around you. People living in hell. Is there choices that resulted in that? There's been many people that I've told over the past 34 years that I've pastored, don't go and do that. If you go doing that, I'm telling you right now, the wages of sin is death. I'm warning you. I'm delivering the word of God to you. That ain't going to work out. They said, no, this is what I want to do. And it was just crash and burn. And now they crash and burn and blaming it on God. No, you chose to go and do that. You chose to do it your own way. Well, why so many people end up in a place called the lake of fire, an eternity without God. Because they're unwilling to just cooperate with his love, cooperate with his grace, cooperate with his mercy. I mean, think about it. If you sin, if you repent for the sin, guess what happens to you? He forgives you. His blood will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Guess what? If you cleanse from all unrighteousness, what are you after that? You're righteous. See, with the heart, man believes unto righteousness. No, not with the heart, man believes unto unrighteousness. That's an antichrist spirit. That's an antichrist scripture. Are you listening to me? Do people believe those kind of things? I mean, we're just all unrighteous. Well, if you're all unrighteous, then who is it that got the gift of righteousness? Who are the righteous that the Lord is coming for? Who are the righteous that belong to the kingdom of heaven? We know that everyone that does righteous is righteous even as he is righteous. That's what God said. So why is it I'm going to believe some doctrine of men when I can be liberated by the truth? Because the truth sets free. I don't have to live in a prison and a lie anymore. I don't have to live outside looking somewhere, you know, with longing eyes. Oh, I would love to be in the inner circle and the inner sanctum. But I've believed a lie. I'm supposed to be out here in the outer camp, the court of the Gentiles, the unclean. Well, come on in. Take a hold of the blood of Jesus Christ. And come boldly. Whew. Huh? We enter in into the holiest of all, the holies of holies, by the blood of Jesus Christ, through a new and living way. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. Amen? When I look at the blood of Jesus Christ, what do I see? I see the means by which I was cleansed from all my sin. Where I'm now no longer spotted with sin. My garments are spotless. Jesus Christ is coming for a church that is without spot or without wrinkle. In that day, the only people that are going to stand before him and be acceptable are those whose garments are white, like fine white linen, which is the righteousness of the saints. I want to know tonight, do you have righteousness?
Yes.
I want to tell you, Christ Jesus is your righteousness. Somebody said, well, there's no good thing in me. Well, then the Holy Ghost, you need to get born again, because the Holy Ghost come live on the side of you. I can't help it. You misunderstood Romans chapter 7. You should have read Romans chapter 6 and Romans chapter 8 a little better. If you would have just read Romans chapter 6 and Romans chapter 8 a little bit better, you wouldn't get stuck in Romans chapter 7. I can't help it that you weren't identified with Romans chapter 7. I did not identify with Romans chapter 7. I identified with Romans chapter 6 and Romans chapter 8. I can't help it that you're identified with the wrong group of scripture. I can't help it that you too identified with there's none righteous, no, not one. I identified with I have received the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He who knew no sin became sin for me, that I might be made the righteousness of God in him. It's about time that you agree with the good things. It's about time that you agree with the good news instead of the bad news. Hallelujah. I mean, there's Satan and his demon hordes are propagating bad news right, left, and center. Everything's going to blow up tomorrow. It's disaster on every hand. It's the disinformation. It's the propaganda of hell. You can know the truth and be in charge. Christ Jesus put us in charge. He gave us authority to tread upon scorpions, serpents, and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means, 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 nothing shall, nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing shall by any means in any way, it's impossible, harm you. Nothing shall by any means harm you. The untouchables. John knew something about a walk with God that all God's people need to want to know. He said, we know that everyone who's been born of God doesn't sin. None of us know that. What on earth? And everybody's wrestled with that. And everybody's trying to change that. And the many multitudes of verses of scripture like that, that John spoke. But we keep ourselves, and the wicked one cannot touch us. Jesus said, Satan comes and he has nothing in me. Little Peter said, we're kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed, the untouchables. Yeah. He says that we have been given a position and a call and a command and a commission to overcome, even as he overcame. This is the overcoming power that overcomes the world, even our faith. What is our faith? The faith of the new birth, the faith to be born again, the faith to be born of the blood, to be born of the spirit, to be born of the word, to be born of the resurrection. Come on now. Don't get tired on me now. Not when you're just about to get activated. I'm going to tell you right now, the body without the Holy Ghost is dead. Huh? The body, the church without the Holy Ghost is dead, just like the living individual body without the Spirit is dead. It's about time you and I come to understand the force of the power of the Holy Ghost, who, if we will begin to yield to him, if we'll let him be God, he will sovereignly begin to move in our lives and develop within our lives all that he has purposed to produce. The fruit of his grace will begin to first blossom and begin to develop and to begin then to be manifested for what it really is and grow and mature unto the full ripe fruit, delicious, glorious expression of the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, the way he described it, he said, unless a seed fall into the earth and die, it abides alone. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. Jesus reproduced himself in every one of those people who have been born again, who have been willing to be changed by the power of God and become a new creation, where every old thing has passed away. See, you're going to have to come to a place in your life where every old thing has passed away. Instead of holding on to all the old things, instead of holding on to all the former things, holding on to the former conversation, you're going to have to be willing to say the old man is crucified and the new man is risen up with Jesus Christ. You're going to have to begin to leave the Word of God instead of your doctrinal ideas, your fundamentalist doctrinal ideas that was born in the heart of Aristotle and bred together with a hybrid with Paul and Peter and Cain. Up to be a mutant that doesn't live but just wiggles and grunts every once in a while and is powerless to produce any life. It's a big mass of jello that has some form or image. You're listening to me? You can't hybridize anything with the Word of God and end up with the Word of God. You can't hybridize a lie with truth and end up with the truth. It always equals a lie. It's like multiplying by zero. I don't care how big the number is, it still ends up zero. Don't mix the truth with a lie. All is just a lie. You should know the truth, and the truth will liberate you. Hallelujah. There is a place for you and I to walk in this blessings of heaven, to walk in the blessings of God, to walk in the life of Jesus, to live out the life of the Holy Ghost. We know that Christ dwells in our hearts right now by faith. We understand that he lives and dwells and abides in us. This is the mystery, the fellowship. This is how you and I begin to take a hold of all that Father has for us. This is how we are matured and perfected, because we recognize and witness that Christ dwells in us, our confidence of glory. Hallelujah. And say, Jesus lives here. Do you live there? Yeah, you do. That's right. You need to get rid of that. Because Paul said, I no longer live, Jesus lives. And so you need to quit living. But it's a volition of your will. It's an agreement. It's what are you going to believe about yourself? Are you going to believe what you teach yourself, your perceptions dictate to you, which you've learned from somebody else, which has been imposed upon you? There's no free thinkers. There's no free spirits, against popular opinion. There's no original ideas. You're not a genius. And you don't want to be, because actually it comes from a word genie, which refers to a fallen angel. You don't want that. Look at the derivation. What is it, Latin or Greek? Greek. Are you with me? Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Place of origin. Greek. Hallelujah. Oh, the word of God. To begin to listen, I write unto you, young men, because the word of God, the living word, Christ Jesus, the written word, hallelujah, that declares who he is. Because he came in the volume of the book. He came from Genesis. He came describing and revealing Genesis 1:1 through Revelation 22:21. You hear me? Behold, I come in the volume of the book. It is written of me, says the Lord. And what is it written of me? To show the full expression of doing the will of the Father. Hallelujah. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is coming into the kingdom, but those who do the will of the Father. That's what Jesus said, Matthew chapter 7. That's what he said. The Holy Ghost has come here to teach us how to live and do the will of the Father. Listen, I write it to you, young men, because the word of God abides in you and you have defeated Satan at every point that he's tried to attack you. I write it to you, young men, because the word of God abides in you and you've overcome Satan at every point. I write it to you, young men, because the word of God abides in you and you've overcome the wicked one. Yes. How? Because the greater one. There's the greater one. Hallelujah. Because the greater one. Come on. Somebody said, oh, he's a wild man. I'm telling you, I'm a spirit man. Listen, because the greater one. Because the greater one lives on the inside of me. Don't believe every spirit, but try the spirit. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. Anyone that doesn't believe the greater one is living on the inside of them is not of God. I'm just going to jump to the point. I can quote the whole verses of scripture. I can quote all of what was being described there by John in 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. I'm just jumping to the point. Does the greater one live on the inside of you? Is the overcoming power live on the inside of you, which is Christ Jesus himself? Hallelujah. Have you received the life of the Lamb into you? Have you received the life of Christ Jesus into you? Have you been born of the Spirit? Do you now live in him? Do you no longer live? Has old things passed away and behold, all things are new? All things are new. You no longer live. The former you no longer lives. But somebody said, well, do I have my will? Is there the realms of self? Absolutely. You have your will. There's the realm of self and the new you. Amen. But the new you needs to be in every way, has been predestinated by God to be conformed to the image of the Son. If you want to talk about predestination, foreordination, election, let me tell you about it. You're supposed to look like, act like, and be like Jesus Christ. That's what God foreordained and elected and predestinated. Read it. Romans 8:29. Read it. As many as walk in the Holy Ghost, these are the sons of God. Believe it. If you don't, you're not the son. You're not a son. Hallelujah. We've got the life of Christ Jesus, the living, the word, be word, the word became the living, the word, the logos, the revelation, the proclamation, the definition, the declaration, the word, the revelation, the definition, the proclamation, the one who fully describes everything that God is became flesh. And dwelt and tabernacled among us. And now tabernacles in us. Because he's reproduced himself on the inside of us through the new birth. That's the new creation. Yes. Behold, all things are new.
Amen.
If any man be in Christ, he is a?
No.
A new creation. A new creature. Nicodemus, you cannot come into the kingdom. You must be born again. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, but that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. You are no longer in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Paul said in Romans 8:9, taking up right there from John 3:3 and 5 and 6. Come on, let the Spirit of the Lord weave together the Word of God as a perfect and complete tapestry before you, and behold, and hallelujah, the image and the glory of God, and there be changed, because all you can see is Jesus about you. Quit seeing the devil about you. Quit seeing some problem child about you. Start seeing someone who's been made new. See, old things have passed away. They gone. Yeah. And anything tried to tell you something about the old, you just say, you stinking lie. I told you, get out of here, Jesus' name. God has given us authority to cast out unclean spirits, to deal with demon spirits, to tell them to go and leave you alone. God has given you the weapons of your warfare, which are not carnal but mighty, to pulling down strongholds, to casting down imaginations. That's about time you start having right imaginations. Wrong imaginations, you cast them down. That's based upon the word of man and of devils. Not much difference, if there is any. But there's holy imaginations. Those are the imaginations of the Word of God, where you see yourself walking in all the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, walking on the water, taking a few loaves and fish. I imagine myself in the crisis that's about to come upon the world and upon the United States of America, having the privilege and opportunity of having, 5, 10, 15, 20,000 people in front of me that don't have any food, and all we got is a couple hot dogs. There's a few hot dogs and a few buns, and we take them and we pray over them and give thanks unto God. I'm telling you, miracles always work when you give thanks. They never work when you give doubt. I'm telling you right now, when you start complaining, no miracle ever happens. But when you begin to thank God in the midst of your crisis, a miracle of multiplication about to happen unto you, spiritually, physically, in every dimension of your life. I don't care what you name that place, God wants to provide you for you in every dimension of your life. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's time that you stop having doubting and unbelief conferences. It's about time you stop receiving counsel from the powers of darkness and start going to the Word of God and communing with the Holy Ghost and talking to Jesus about all the great things that He's provided for you in Himself. Hallelujah. It's about time you stop setting your affections upon the things of the earthly realm and start setting your affections upon things above, where you're seated together with Christ Jesus. Ann and I were driving down the road the other night. I don't know, I just got hit with it. I said, baby, you know where we're going? And she's thinking, what? I think I do. And because it's kind of revelation, we're getting ready to go into some major adventures. Could you imagine what we're going to be doing like 20,000 years from right now? I mean, God's getting ready to take us some places. I'm telling you, this thing is getting ready to blow wide open, man. This thing is getting ready to get really big. This thing is getting ready to go off the charts. Can you imagine what we're going to be doing a billion years from now? Can you imagine what's going to happen as soon as we cross over from this life into the next life and we begin to behold Him and we begin to see all that really is taking place around us? What we would call the microscopic, the invisible now, that is the source of all the tangible and all the macroscopic, all the visible and all that we see and try to understand from a physical realm, being dictated by that which right now is invisible but soon to be revealed and unveiled. It's going to be unveiled. If your eyes were open, if our eyes were open like the prophet, we would begin to see, like the prophet's servant, we begin to see that the heavens are filled with the host of God, that there's more with us than are with them.
Yes.
We'll begin to see the very source and power and force behind all those mechanisms of life and physical features of life that we think we understand.
Amen.
We don't have a clue. That's why you continually have new additions. Oops. The things I was taught in biochemistry back in 1984, I mean, that's folklore now. Hey? It's just the way it works. Just the way it is. You know, the things that we exalt high and think that are so amazing and brilliant and insightful. My goodness, dear people. 60, 70 years ago, chemistry was an esoteric science still. I mean, all these are just new things. God's word has been absolute and perfect forever. Hallelujah. I mean, it's just always working. And there's always a tangible outworking and result of those things which he said. And he wants to reproduce in your life everything he declared so that you can be a data point of evidence that everything he said is true.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 I'm a reproducible data point of everything that God said in his word is a living reality. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the only thing you can put 100% confidence interval around. Praise the name of Jesus. This is absolute. I want you to step over and make it absolute. I want you to make it real right now. If I can get people to agree right now, they're going to get healed. If I can get people to agree right now, they're going to get filled. If I can get people to agree right now, all that they have needed is going to be provided for them. Well, I've been believing God for $1 million. You don't need no $1 million. You're not doing anything that requires $1 million. Get yourself busy in the kingdom. You might need it. Then you'll get it. All these many of the things that you're asking for, you ask it. It's a miss. It's a fantasy. It's for nothing. It's just something you're asking out of the realms of your own thinking, out of the realms of your own desire. Quit asking like that and start asking out of the will of the Father, out of the purposes of God. And look, watch what's going to happen. Start making the most important things the most important thing. Start seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, the righteousness of God, the realms of everything the Father possesses. He's opened the door. The door is Christ Jesus. He's inviting everybody. Come on in. You don't need a special key. Hallelujah. Just come in. The door is open. Christ Jesus, the truth, the life, the way. I come to the Father by him. I live in all that Father has for me, is provided freely for me. I receive it by living and dwelling in him. Christ lives in me. I live in him. I no longer live. It's Christ who lives. I don't know myself after the flesh anymore. I know myself after the Spirit. Paul said we don't even know Jesus after the flesh anymore, but we know him after the Spirit. We're not to know each other after the flesh anymore, but we're supposed to know each other after the Spirit. It's about time you understand who you are after the Spirit. If you want to understand who you are after the Spirit, then you're going to have to go to the Word, because only the Word of God to describe that to you, because everybody else is going to tell you something different. They're going to remember everybody around you is going to remember all your faults, failings, and every upset and mistake you ever made. That's what they're going to remember. That's what they're going to remind you of. That's what they're going to think about you as soon as you start acting like you're delivering the Word of God. Well, I remember when you messed up. They're going to think extremely negative. They're going to be critical. They're going to be suspicious. They're going to live in strife and envy and divisions and jealousies. Oh, come on over here into this love.
Yeah.
Come on over here into happy land. Come on over Shapahai. Come on over Rubasa. Come on over here into heaven. Get so excited about how excited Jesus is about you. Knowing and believing the love that God has for you. See him. As the prophet Zephaniah said in Zephaniah 3:17, see him dancing over you. See him dancing over you. Singing, writing a song about you. Woo! Hallelujah. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the love of the Father? I could see how far I was watching. The new Exodus movie, Gods and Kings, just looking at it, just evaluating it, saying, how can people be so far off? Where did they get their information? Just in awe. I mean, the first time I watched it, I said, that's dark. I had to watch it again because it was so dark. I had to try to figure out where people's heads are at. And they make God a little guy who's angry and fussy. They're screaming and hollering. And Moses, a guy who's screaming and hollering back. And there's no idea, no concept of who he is. No, and what he wants us to become those who go in his stead, who speak on his behalf. Who will go for me? Who will be my ambassador? Who will show the world around them what I'm like? Jesus said, if you see me, you've seen the Father. And what is he describing the Father to be? One who walks in meekness and lowliness and purity. One who walks in a place of this constantly giving selflessness. This wonderful love. This wonderful display of the nature of God. And Peter tells and sings out to us in the Word, we have been made partakers of His divine nature, of His lowliness, of His meekness, of His gentleness, of His righteousness, of His purity, of His justness, of His compassions, of His mercy, of His forgiveness, of His peace, of His godliness, hallelujah, of all these wonderful things that describe who He is. Modern day preachers would never enter in on the great day of debut as Jesus did. On the great day, of the most highlighted day of His ministry, Jesus came not on a white stallion, not on a Rolls Royce, not in a caravan with a bunch of guards around Him, with people blowing the horn saying, here He comes, the man of God, the man of the hour, the man of power. He came meek and lowly, riding upon a little donkey. Little donkey. That's like a worse than a VW coming in and out of the VW. He didn't need all the stuff to make Him who He was. He is the great I Am. He's everything. He's fully endowed with all that He ever wants to be. He doesn't need anything else. And He's given to us of Himself. And out of Him, you and I get to be now complete. We get to be complete. We're not half-baked anymore. We're complete. We're not looking for other missing parts. We're complete. Hallelujah. Be complete, hallelujah. Who is the head? We're complete in Him who is the head over the body. Hallelujah. Who's the head over the church. Who's supposed to be the head over our lives. If we're connected with Him, the supply of heaven, if we got the proper connection, the supply of heaven is going to continually flow. If we got the proper connection with those who are closest to us, our spouse, our family, our brothers, our sisters, you know, I'm going to tell you right now, Peter said, he said, dwell with your wives according to knowledge. Otherwise, your prayers are going to be hindered. You're going to miss out on the connection, the supply. I mean, if your prayers aren't hindered, you're going to get whatever you want. Get it right. Start loving. Somebody said, how am I going to do it? God's going to pour His love in your heart by the Holy Ghost. And He's going to continue to fill you. As long as you're willing to be filled, you can continue to be overwhelmed by a divine supply. You've been now put together in the right way that enables you to receive that which the Holy Ghost supplies before when you were in your sin, when you were in that place not knowing God, before that time that you encountered God and became a new creation, you could not receive anything that God wants to supply. Everything that God has was impossible for you to receive. They were even foolish. They were meaningless. They were void of value and meaning. That kind of foolishness. But now, because of this new creation, because He's given us a new spirit, and our spirit is joined unto His spirit, hallelujah, the things of heaven become valuable to us. Now, we in the proper position and disposition before Him that we can begin to receive all that He has, so long as we're willing to obey Him and do what He says to do. He'll give you the power to forgive. You know where forgiveness comes from? Mercy. You know where mercy comes from? Love. I mean, the love just overwhelming us and this outworking of God. Who, the wisdom of God, where that you just have great compassion for people and you don't hold their stupidity against them. Huh? You don't hold their childish behavior against them. You don't hold their faults against them. You don't hold their ignorance against them. You don't hold their self-centeredness against them. You don't hold their misperceptions against them. Everybody thinks they have a brilliant photographic memory, 100% recall till they take a test. You know what I'm saying? It's amazing. Get everybody in the room. They're all brilliant. They have photographic memories. I remember exactly what you said. I remember word for word. Get them in this classroom, have them take a test, and they're blessed that they get an 80%. 80% recall. Huh? And that's after studying it for hours upon hours and hours and hours. Not just hearing it one time, huh? We got to get out of ourselves and start getting over into the things that He has provided for us in Himself, in Himself. Jesus said, I do nothing of myself. I've devoted myself to being in Him, doing what He wants. If we would decide tonight that we're no longer going to live to do our own will, but to do the will of the Father, you know what we would do? We wouldn't give ourselves permission anymore to decide. We wouldn't even give ourselves the right anymore to our own opinion. We say, Father, what did you say? Somebody said to me, I don't know whether they were, you know, trying to insult me or not, but they said to me the other day, they said, you don't even have your own opinion. You always trust everything with the Bible. And I'm like, thank you. That's what I want to be. That's what I want to do. To begin to live by the word. Hallelujah. Kaprokasateya. To submit to the things of the word. To have the beauty and the blessings of the word. The living word, Christ Jesus. Which the written word describes. Listen, here's what I feel. I feel an explosive working of the power of God, resident, present right here in this place. I want everybody to be right because I want you to be ready for what God has purposed to do through your life. Father's purpose to prepare you unto every good work. I'm telling you, the people that are in this place to raise you up, to begin to bear witness unto himself, to begin to give witness of the reality of heaven, to begin to give witness to the reality that Christ Jesus isn't dead, that he raised from the dead, and that he's alive and he's king of heaven right now, to bear witness unto him and to his resurrection, to give witness to the authority that now there is a new breed, that there is a new generation, that there is a new kind. Almost like to say the new species. Hallelujah. A people who have been made alive in Christ Jesus by the power of God, who now live as the family of God here in an earthly realm, in an earthly physical realm. I mean, you think about Jesus, it's amazing, the eternalness of God. He is the everlasting. He's from everlasting to everlasting. He is the great I am. He is the eternal word. But forever he will be in a human resurrected body with nail scars in his hands. Forever he will be in that which he submitted himself to when he became flesh and took upon the form of a servant. In this great love and passion that Father has for each one of us so that he might redeem us. Oh, to know and believe the love that God has for us. I mean, if God spared not his own son but offered him up for the sins of us all, how shall he not also by him freely give us all things? That's Romans 8:32. If you want to memorize a verse of scripture, get that one and just start telling that to yourself every day. This is a living reality, and if I will agree with this, and if I will believe it, and if I'll begin to allow the word of God to produce fruit in my life, I'm gonna have all that he freely is supplying. And I'm going to have the proof. I'm going to see my proof in something that has already taken place. I'm going to predict the future based upon what already took place in the past. I'm going to produce what God's going to do for me in the future based upon what God did for me in the past. I'm going to see a living example of a miracle providing God who's never going to cease nor fail in any way to continue to pour out all that he has to anyone who's willing to receive. Right now, his eyes go to and fro looking. He's looking right now. He's looking at you. Right now, he's longing. He's calling out anyone who come and believe, who will stand with him in this purpose. I feel an explosive, miraculous power of God about to be released in a sovereign way through the people who've been crying out to God and giving him no rest night and day, saying, oh God, I must have more. Lord, I want an increase in your manifest presence. Lord, I want an increase in your anointing. Lord, I want an increase in those things that you have freely provided for those who are willing to receive. Listen, Satan will come along with all of his lies, and people will try to exalt themselves, and the only way they can exalt themselves is to make you less.
Yeah, that's right.
And to try to strip from you that which God has made, has given, and supplied. That really results in just a leveling floor where there's no big I's and little U's. Hallelujah. We just all in Christ Jesus, and he's the one to be praised. Where that everything that he has, he's made available to everyone. There's nobody left out. Anyone who believes will do these works and greater works. Anyone. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. Hallelujah. They will cast out devils to speak with new tongues. I want you to find, tonight as we serve you communion, I want you to find something that he's freely given you in his kiss, in his hug, in his desperate love for you. And in that which he takes a hold of us and he holds on to us and he will not let us go. He passionately pursues us. We're the ones called sought out. Somebody said, we're chasing God. I'm afraid God's chasing us. And we should need to stop running. That's my way I say I'm afraid he's chasing us, because we're running on our own way. Listen, I'm going to go do this for God. God's trying to catch up with us. Listen, no. I just want you to come over here. We're those sought out of the Lord, because he sought us out. We didn't choose him. He chose us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He come sought us out. He called us. He elected us. He's purposed us to live in all the glory of heaven, to where right now, at this moment in time, we can begin to experience that which we will have in him throughout the ages. We begin to touch a realm to where that this life-giving flow is so powerful, sickness and disease cannot find any place within our lives or in the lives of the people that we touch and come in contact with. Where devils have to, when we come around, devils cry out and leave. I mean, you know, I heard of different people, and I mean, like, for example, Charles Finney, he would go into a hotel, he would go into a town, and the town would begin to shake under the power of God. And he would find himself just basically trying to go get something to eat, or trying to, you know, just do normal everyday things, and he was prevented from doing it because people would get saved right, left, and center. And there was always this great stirring of great compassion for people. He never looked at people in any other way than to see them being rescued from the snare of the devil and the power of hell. That's the way he looked at people. But he noticed and he reported how that when his prayer life subsided, he spent 4, 5, 6 hours a day in prayer. When he wasn't in prayer, the flow of the Holy Ghost wasn't there. He wasn't effective in reaching lost. That same manifest presence of God, he wasn't yielded to. And people think about that in a modern day society and say, my goodness, 4 or 5 hours. I thought this was all free. Where are we going to find 4 or 5 hours of prayer? Listen, I'm not saying that. That's something that's growing. I mean, somebody grew and matured into that. I'm saying just begin to find the beauty. See, I want you to begin to find the beauty of enjoying his presence. If you can just find the beauty of his presence and begin to enjoy his presence, that's where he speaks to you. I'm telling you, when you just begin to enjoy the beauty of his presence, just being captivated by him, that's where you begin to talk to him. That's the kind of prayer that he wants to hear. That's where the Spirit of the Lord begins to speak through you. People get all frustrated and all bound up trying to make things work. I mean, there's too many people who fast because of being led by discouragement about themselves. They fast. No, you need to be led by the Holy Ghost and fast. You know what I'm saying? They let out of disappointment to fast. They let out of a sense of failure to fast. No, you need to be led out of the Holy Ghost to fast. They let out of, you know, these various different things to, in their interaction with God, other than enjoying his presence and the sweet fellowship of interacting with him. I just want you to discover this wonderful, beautiful realm called heaven, this wonderful encounter with God that leaves you captivated, raptured, and just in awe. God has this for you. Get out of all the other things, because it's just frustrating and it's a lot of effort that doesn't go very far at all. It's a lot of energy that's expended without a lot of results in return. If you can just begin to enjoy his presence. If you can just begin to do like Daniel did and just stretch forth your hands and begin to give thanks to him. That's what Daniel did. He just gave thanks to the Lord. He wasn't always praying like he did in the prayer of Daniel chapter 9. He's just giving thanks. He's just giving thanks to the Lord. Thanking him and praising him for all the wonderful things that he is and that he's done and that he does. So begin to enjoy the presence of the Lord. Begin to enjoy a fellowship. Begin to enjoy a communion. Begin to enjoy a supply of life, a supply of forgiveness, a supply of acceptance, a supply of oneness, a provision to make you everything that he is, make you everything that is acceptable to him. That's what communion is about. It's just recognizing that this manifest presence, this dwelling presence of the living God is here with us, and he's supplying to us the provision that we have need of for whatever it is that we find ourselves in. Whatever it is. We find ourselves in need of healing, he's there, he's a provider for that. We find ourselves in need of protection, he's there, he's protecting us. What a wonderful place. You'll never be afraid again. Perfect love will just cast out all the fear. You'll never be in doubt again, because love will produce faith in you. a confidence knowing that God hears me. A fellowship that brings us into a place of whatever we ask. We know that whatever we ask, whatever we ask Him, He's going to do it. We know that. And because we know that, that whatever we ask, that is a realm of fellowship, dear people. That's a realm of something that you begin to participate with today, tomorrow, throughout the week, next week. It's a realm of fellowship that you participate with by not allowing there to be offenses going on between you and anyone else, problems, issues, criticisms. And that is just simply an overflow of the fellowship that you have with Him. And that love that just dominates you, just forgiving everybody. I was thinking this morning, I wonder if there was anything that I could ever do to my wife to cause her not to love me as much as she loves me. Because in my realm of thinking, there's such a pure love there, it would be like asking the question, I wonder if there's anything I could do to my mother to cause her not to love me as she's loved me. You hearing me?
Yes.
We're not living on the edge of a broken relationship. We're not living on the edge of a breach. We're living deep in a communion and a fellowship that nothing can bust or break apart.
Amen.
Huh? You reckon there is? I would never want to experiment. I would never want to violate the love because the love would compel me not to. Can you hear what I'm saying? Do you hear the overtones?
Yeah.
I'm talking to you about your relationship with the Lord. I'm not just talking about my relationship with my wife. I want you to get married to a person you can have a relationship with like that. And those that you're married to right now, I want you to get things right and submitted to God so that you can have a relationship with that like that. Because we only have that kind of relationship because our relationship is submitted to Him. We're both going after the same thing. We both want the same thing. I'm not interested in pleasing anyone as much as I'm interested in pleasing Him. I'm not interested in hearing anybody tell me, hey, I did a great job, as much as I'm interested in hearing Him telling me, I did a great job. I'm not interested in anybody telling me, well done, as much as I'm interested in hearing Him tell me, well done. I'm interested in His favor. I'm interested in His honor. Hallelujah. And I tell you, that's just the right place that you want to be. It's where you want to be. Thank you, Lord. And I have many other things like this to say to you. And I just so blessed. It was hard for me to stop the meeting this morning. And I just so thankful for the people who stayed till 2:30 and then came back to the meeting tonight. But for me, it was just in heaven. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I want you to learn how to make the problems and the issues that surround you irrelevant. By making Christ Jesus and His heavenly call for your life the only thing that is relevant, the only thing that is important. All the rest is meaningless. So your house burns down. Big deal. Meaningless. So they kick you out of school and you fail every class. Big deal. Meaningless. So your car blows up or gets stolen. Big deal. Meaningless. So there's no fruit on the vine, no calf in the stall. No rejoicing, no making merry. Meaningless. I should go up on my high place.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I should go in that place. I should rejoice in the Lord, my God. I should go up upon my high place and hear what He has to say as He examines and corrects me. Hear Habakkuk, the prophet. Hear that. Hear what he's saying. Can you hear Paul and Silas? Paul who's suffered the loss of all things but counted them but done because he was caught away in the beauty and the splendor. And here he is. His reward, as it were, was to be in prison, stripped naked and beaten in public, set in prison and chained to a wall in a cell. They did not have a TV. a weight room, a bed. It was a cell, a dungeon, a hole in the ground. A terrible, dark place. And what is he doing? He can't see nothing. I guarantee you, the kind of cell that he would have been, he couldn't see his hand in front of his face. What were they doing? Singing and praising God. Hallelujah. Huh? Look at Peter. Look at Peter, his walk with God. Huh? They killed James, and now they're going to kill him. You know what he's doing? He's really scared. He's concerned. He's snoring. He's so fast asleep. They're going to kill him next day. He's not concerned. Nobody sleeps on death row when you're going to get killed in the morning unless they've cast all their cares upon him, unless they're captivated by a living God, unless God is their God and he is their people. And he's so sound asleep, it took a time for the angel to wake him up. The angel had to smite him, had to smack him to get him up. And then he was still in such a slumber, he was all outside the prison before he even realized that he wasn't still dreaming. I mean, you talk about sweet sleep and peace in God. Come on, people. Come on, man. I'm telling you, somebody just gets threatened over some little nonsense nothing, and they all up in arms and can't get asleep, a wink of sleep all night. Huh? Can't get a moment of peace. Come on! It's time to find yourself completely given over to divine purposes where nothing else even matters anymore, but that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that your place and your assignment in God is secure in Him. Hallelujah. You're living under the divine reign of heaven. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Can somebody please help me over there, Cade and Joshua and Ruth? You know, I thought tonight, I was on my way here, and I thought, man, I just, there's so many people to honor for all the things, the way that they labor, I mean, in the kingdom and the things that they do. I mean, I was thinking about Rob, how He's been CFO for the church for so many years. But I thought, my goodness, if I started telling about everything that everybody is doing, we just have to have everybody stand up. But that's great. I mean, because that's just the kind of church to be in, where everybody's participating in what God's got for them. We just want you to step into another realm and dimension of growth and maturity in Christ Jesus. When we recognize that all of his fullness is available, we're going to constantly be provoking you to say, come on, man, don't stop there. There's still more. I know it's good. I know God's done a lot of great things, but he wants to do a whole lot more through you. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful for all that the Lord's done in my life. And I'm going to tell you right now, somebody said, well, you know, you haven't done as much as so-and-so. Well, you know, I'm not comparing myself to so-and-so, and I advise you not to do that either. I'm just captivated by what God's done in my life. I can't believe all that he's done in my life. I'm so excited. If I was sitting around comparing myself and contrasting myself to everybody else, I might be as bummed out as somebody else is. But I'm not. I'm just captivated by what he's doing in me. I want you to be captivated about what he's doing in your life so you can become so thankful for all that God has done in you, that you're still here today after all that you've done, after all that you've been through. I mean, I'm telling you right now, God re-lifted me up out of a miry pit. I was polluted in my own blood. I was cast out, as it were, and forsaken. And he come washed me and cleansed me. Hallelujah. Put royal garments upon me. Put a crown upon my head. And so has he done the same for you. Hallelujah. I tell you, every one of you, just like Joseph to Jacob, every one of you, the Lord's made a special coat, a special garment, a special coat of many colors for you. Hallelujah. There's a special call upon your life, a special mantle of the Spirit, a special provision, a special measure that's been given to you in Christ Jesus. It's about time you start developing in it. It's about time you start forsaking the things that are the past and stop holding on and clinging to the things that you have up to this point. Start taking hold of those things that Father has before you, because I'm telling you, it's going to go even beyond. It's going beyond all that he wants to express to your life here in this world. Because the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus is the resurrected body that looks just like his. so that when we see him, we will see him as he is, so we should be like him. And that is so amazing. I'm living for that day. I'm not living to have, you know, just, I mean, I want God to use me to reach lots of people. I want to be used in every way to fully represent him as he's described in purpose. But I'm living for the day to behold him and to be, as he is, for I should be like him. I'm looking for the day of resurrection when I'm changed. Hallelujah. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And you know what? I mean, I might go by way of the grave. I would love to think that I'm going to be one of those who doesn't see death and is captured, caught away, who's changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. But I might go by way of the grave. But either way, we which are alive and remain. See, Paul believed he was going to be one of those who were caught away. He said, but we which are alive and remain shall not prevent them that are dead. Huh? For the dead in Christ shall rise first.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet him in the air.
Thank you, Lord.
And therefore comfort one another with these words.
Yes.
Some people, that ain't a comfort anymore. I don't know what's going on. But nonetheless, I don't understand people so confused about their doctrinal ideas. But the reality of it is the beauty and the splendor. That if I die, I still go first. Huh? There's a you get blessed. No matter what company you're in. If I die, I go first. I get changed before everybody's alive gets changed. And it's all at the same time, though. The Lord will descend with a shout, with the voice of an archangel.
Yeah.
And we shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. Thank you, Jesus. It's a miracle that's about ready to happen. Some people ask me about when do I think the end of the world is coming. I really wouldn't be so concerned about that if I were you. I'd be concerned about when your end is coming. More than likely, your end is going to come before any great event is going to come. You better be ready. There's not a single person who knows the measure of days that have been numbered out to them that God himself has ordained for your life. He knows, and you need to spend your every day and every moment in awe of him. You need to be able to take a hold of the wisdom that he has supplied to you by his Spirit so that you can number your days and apply your heart unto wisdom to be prepared for that day. There's nothing more important than to prepare for that day. There's nothing greater. There is not a greater witness that you've been born again. There's not a greater testimony that you belong to God than the power and the authority to overcome the devil, to overcome sin. This is the power that overcomes the world, even our faith. This is the overcoming power that overcomes. Jesus didn't say the signs and wonders and miracle workers. He said, if you overcome as I overcame, he was, my goodness gracious, then you will sit down with me in my throne as I sit down with my Father in his throne. And here's the beautiful thing. When I think about that scripture, you know what I immediately think about? I think about the overcomer who lives in me, the greater one who lives in me. I don't even have to overcome on my own overcoming ability. I got the overcoming power of Christ Jesus. I got the overcoming power of the blood of the Lamb. I've got a means and a provision where Satan cannot come and sit down in my life and claim me. I get the provision. We have the provision. Where every plague and every disease and everything that may be poured out upon men will have to pass over us. We have a provision. We sealed by the Spirit of the living God. Satan cannot ever come and claim us. He may try to come and claim us, but he's not going to be prevented by an angel. He's going to be prevented by Jesus. I mean, you think about how that the devil wrestled with the angel over Moses' body. Huh? Trying to claim him. Pretty radical, isn't it? How rebellious, how defiant. How much Satan believes he owns you and that you are his. He's not going to let you go. Praise God for Jesus. Praise God for the Savior. Praise God for the Deliverer. And I want you to know the place of safety. The name of the Lord is a high tower. The righteous run in and are saved. I'm telling you, the Word of God is a certain defense. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. I want to give this communion. I want all of you, please, if you would, just hold on to the communion until we just all have it together. And just really believing, I'm really just believing tonight that as you partake in the breaking of the body and of the pouring out of the blood, these tokens of the communion and the fellowship, that your eyes will be open. You begin to see things in the spirit concerning who God is towards you, who he is in you, how much he loves you, what he's purposed for you to be and to do, that you get out of the imaginations that make you less than what he created you to be in him, that you get out of the former things that would try to hold you back in the conversation and lifestyle that you had before you became a new creation, that you put away concerning the former things, that you recognize and that you agree with God, that you're a new creation, the old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. That's recognizing what the blood has done for you. Yes. Tonight, that you will recognize that you've been made partaker of the divine nature. Hallelujah. As you partake of the body and of the blood, Jesus said, he that eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me.
Yes.
Yeah, that's why. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. What is that? Is that John 6:53 or is it John 6:56? He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me. Could you open your Bible there? But while Ann's doing that, I want this section, would you just stand up and just form a line and just let me serve you communion? Joshua, I want you to play, son. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Love you. Anybody you don't love? Huh? Love you. Anybody you don't love? Love you. You love everybody? Love you. You love everybody? Love you. You loving everybody? Has anybody got a problem with it?
No.
Love you, Geneva. Isn't it amazing the anointing that Father's placed in Geneva's life? It's amazing. When you see a minister of the gospel up against it, start beginning to release those things which God has supplied to you. The other night, when I could see that. My dear friend Richard was up against it a little bit, struggling a bit. I just stepped right in there, you know. Huh? I began to flow in a greater way. Just got a little bit more vocal. Huh? Because we begin to join in and pull the miracle that happens. So, Jeanine, we love you. Is anybody you don't love? Huh? You got it? Honey. Whoa. Baby, you take your love to a whole nother level over here. Had to examine myself. But thank you so much, baby. Love you, baby. Anybody you got a problem with?
No.
Love you. You loving everybody? Huh? You got to hold on to that, baby. You know what that is? It represents what? The body of Jesus, right? That's right. And as soon as you're old enough to know that, Joshua, you're going to go take care of you. Joshua. You loving everybody? Now, you know what? When we hearken back, I want you to understand this. When we hearken back to where the first communion was served, as it were, on the night of Passover, when they ate the lamb, they got the lamb in them. Disease and sickness went because there was no sick or feeble one among them. Amen? I'll tell you right now, people don't even recognize that if you eat it and drink it unworthily, you eat and drink damnation. And for this cause, many are sick and sleep or die. But if you eat and drink it on the reverse side, you eat and drink it on the reverse side, you ain't going to be sick. Hallelujah. And you're not going to die before your time. Yeah, the appointed day. Satan's not going to be able to set up some premature death, some accident. Man, I'll tell you right now, Ed and I got some miracles on that. We got some miracle stories. We had one night a car pass through us. And we had, and the car passed through us. And we looked in our mirror, and he was still sitting there in the middle of the rain, in the middle of the road. And he sat there a long time, because I could still see him in my rearview mirror about a mile and a half away. He's still there as long as he passed through us. I was drunk in the Holy Ghost, left the meeting at 4 o'clock in the morning, didn't turn on my lights and drive on the interstate. And somebody come off the highway onto the exit, and I was just going as he was going on the exit. All I did was see the lights. So the lights, right there. And then I looked in my rearview mirror and he was sitting right behind me. God, I tell you right now, ain't nothing, no evil thing can befall you. Flame can't, fire can't kindle on you. You guys in love?
Yes.
You guys in love?
Yes.
I love you.
Love you too.
If it ever strikes, if anything ever strikes, comes across you and says, he doesn't love me, you rebuke it. That ain't the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost isn't telling you, hey, so-and-so don't love you. Love you, my dear brother. Bless you. The Holy Ghost remember coming along and saying, hey, they don't love you. He would never do that. Isn't that pretty easy to discern? To begin to walk in basic Holy Ghost discernment. You get your senses exercised in the realms of discernment, to discern good and evil, what God the Holy Ghost is saying, what the powers of darkness is saying, because of the use of the word. Love you, dear. Is anybody you don't love? Are you doing good?
Yes.
Love you, dear. Bless your darling heart. Are you in love with everybody?
Yeah.
Everybody's forgiven?
Yeah.
And what's your name?
Nathan.
Praise God, Nathan. Bless you. Love you. I'm sure that you don't have any unforgiveness in your heart. Good. Amen. If you did, if you did, you wouldn't have to do too much. You know why? Because God the Holy Ghost is here to speak to us. It'd be looming out at you right now. If people had unforgiveness, Satan can create unforgiveness. He'll create a lie. Oh, you don't love somebody. But he can't do it right here. He's going to have to get you off somewhere where the flow isn't happening. Because right now, all that can show up is the truth. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And you can live like this all the time. Hallelujah. Love you, dear. You love everybody?
Yes.
Anybody you got a problem with?
No.
Love you, Grace. Are you good?
Yes.
You love everybody?
Yes.
Anybody have any unforgiveness against?
That's good.
Amen. Love everybody?
Love everybody.
Well, if you just stayed right there, then you properly connected so that you can receive what the head is supplying. Because the head is supplying. If you hold the head in the right position, right in his proper place, it's the one who supplies all that you need, then his supply to every bend and joint, to the whole of your being, individually and collectively, so that you may increase with the increase of God. Love you, buddy. I think your dancing skills are improving.
Thank you.
I've been blessed by them.
Praise the Lord.
And blessed with it. I told somebody the other day, by the Spirit of the Lord, and I saw that they were just reaching out for more of the things of the Spirit in their life. And I said to the person, they're a little bit heavy. And I said, did you ever learn how to dance? They looked at me shocked. I said, have you ever danced? You know how to dance, don't you? And reluctantly, the person shook their head, yes. I said, you need to dance more. Dance before the Lord. Just out of joy. Just out of praise. A lot of folks don't get that. I hope you get that. I hope that next time you start feeling bad, you'll just start breaking out into a dance. Just dance before the Lord. Just bless him, Lord. And just set your whole, turn the whole thing around.
Love you.
Is there anybody got a problem with? Joshua, when he was a little guy, he'd get to crying because his teeth were coming in or whatever, something's going on. I recognized all I had to do was get that bad thought out of his head and get him distracted with something good. And it was all just good. Everything just changed. We want you to do that. We want you to begin to change things. God has given you the ability. He has supplied you the ability to turn things around in your life. Are you guys in love?
Yes.
Are you just loving? You ain't got any forgiveness, unforgiveness?
No.
I almost said you got any forgiveness. I love you. Love you. You're too young to have unforgiveness. So are you. Yeah. Praise God. We love you, dear. Hallelujah. It's a big joy about being a child, too young to be have hurts and offenses in your life. Love you. How are you doing?
Doing great.
Oh, that's good. Love you too. You loving everybody?
See.
Especially the Father. Are you in love with Father? How many of you in love with Father?
Yes.
How are you doing?
Doing great.
Are you loving everybody?
Yes, sir.
You think everybody's really special?
Yes, sir.
You're honoring everyone?
Yes, sir.
Esteeming everybody better than yourself?
Yes, sir.
No, I believe that about you. Tyler, love you. How are you guys doing? You in love?
So in love.
Huh? Do you love the little guy? And we pray in Jesus' name that it would be received with the same response about everyone. Hey, how are you doing, sweetie? Bless you. Love you, darling. How are you doing, baby? You know what this represents? See, that represents Jesus' body. Say Jesus' body.
Body.
Say Jesus.
Jesus.
Body.
Body.
Amen.
Amen.
Love you, baby. Love you. Are you guys doing good?
Awesome.
You in love?
Yes. I'm just daddy.
Good, baby. Any JJ, love you, buddy. How are things going? You guys in love? Huh? Any unforgiveness?
No.
Good. Anybody got a problem with? That's good. I try to break it all down here. Those people you got a problem with, something you hold them against. You got a problem with it because you hold something against them. Has anybody yet matured enough to love the unlovely, the obnoxious? I started saying to the Lord, baby, love you, sweet Faith, Judah. I started saying to the Lord, see, when we were born in sin and shaped in iniquity, we learned how to hate people when we first met them. Dislike them, find some problem with them. Every once in a while, one out of a billion, you'd find a kindred spirit. I mean, you know what I'm saying. It's about that bad, living in hate and envy. Huh? But when we were born in righteousness and shaped in purity by the Holy Ghost and being shaped, the Lord wants to teach us how to walk in His love. And I just said, Lord, I just want to learn how to love people in the first 5 seconds of meeting them. And I just said, Lord, I want to learn how to just love people instantaneously, to not find anyone that I dislike, to even start loving the violently obnoxious. Listen to me, Dwayne. The things that have hindered you and bound you, as it were, from moving forward in the blessing of God in the realms of finances. It's like always been looming. It's just right there. And even when God blessed you, you just generously gave to a ministry that the Lord laid upon your heart to do it, to give to. Listen. I'm telling you, that evil spirit, that power of darkness that would try to prevent you, that curse that would try to impose itself upon you, it's broken in the name of Jesus Christ. From this day forward, the thing turns around. You will not be confined. You will not be confined. You will not be confined to some small place in God. Love you. You love everybody? You love Hey, buddy. Love you. Bless you, man. You know what this is? You know what this represents? Yes, that's right. That good job. Praise God. Hallelujah. Wesley and Noah. I mean, my goodness. Love you, dear. How are you doing? You love everybody? You got a problem with anybody? You don't have any offense against anyone?
No.
Just loving on, no matter what they've done. Amen. Good. Praise the name of Jesus. This is what, we're going to just start having communion a lot, and this is just the way to break into it. Amen. Love you. Love you, man. Isn't it good to walk with the Lord? Here. Enjoy. Amen. How are you doing? That's good. Love you. How are you?
Good.
Bless you. Love you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Thank you, Shikananea. Every month. This section, would you just come? Stand up here. Come, just come on and just charge her. Love you. Love you, Claire. Thank you, Father, for the anointing right over there. Love you, Leslie. Love you, Brittany. Love you, Mike. What a blessing you are. Love you, Jonathan. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Love you, buddy. Bless you. Hallelujah. Love you, Brad. Thank you, Father, for all that you've done through Brad. Blessing us. Love you. How are you doing?
I'm blessed.
You love everybody?
I do.
I know you do. Love you. Thank you so much. Love you too. Bless you. How are you doing?
Wonderful.
You loving everybody?
Yes, I am.
Got anybody you got a problem with?
No.
That's good. Love you. Caleb. Grab a hold of the bread. Don't let go. Love you, Sarah. Got it. How are you doing? You're doing great? That's good. You honoring everybody? Huh? Are you giving yourself to learning how to esteem everybody better than yourself? It's not going to be a little bit challenging, can it? Did you know that? Did anybody ever notice that that's a little bit challenging? Just check it. Hey, what's this? What does this represent?
Jesus' body.
Yes, that's right. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. How are you doing?
Good.
You love everybody? Got an offense against anyone? Problem with anybody? Then you're free to receive everything that God has and live a very happy life and full of the things of the heaven. The moment you start having an offense against somebody, you shut down the supply of heaven. You don't get to live in the abundance. So it ain't worth it. You know what I'm saying?
No.
It ain't worth it. Love you, dear. Hallelujah. Love you, dear. Love you, dear. Thank you very much. Kasukaranea. Hallelujah. Love you. Got your Christmas hat on there? Love you, dear. Bless you. Hey, man. How are you doing? Love you, man. Bless you. Tukara state. Jazz. So blessed. See what God's doing in your life. Tokodamante. How are you? You're doing good?
Yes.
You know that we love you?
Yes.
You know that I love you?
Yes.
How do you feel about me?
Good.
Huh? Yes. Huh?
Good.
And I said, how do you feel about me?
Wonderful. Wonderful.
And do you like me?
Yes.
Can you say that?
Yes, I love you.
There you go. Yeah, he's wanted a witness. Hey guys, love you guys. How are you doing? Love you. You know, I like the matzah better. It just makes a whole lot more mess. This guy's just hard to get a serious piece of tortilla out there. Hey, love you, man.
Yeah, I know. I know you love me extra.
Hey. How do you feel about me?
Oh, I feel very great. How about you?
I love you, dear.
I'll be watching.
Carlos, love you, man. How are you?
I'm good.
Bless you. Love you.
Thank you.
Good with everyone? Love everybody?
Yes.
No offense against anyone? That's awesome. And you're just so freed up, you know. You receive everything God has for you. Just living in that love.
Yes.
This wonderful love that was expressed when Jesus gave his own flesh as food for us. Isn't he wonderful? The bread of heaven. Amen. Love you, dear. Oh, I did. Okay. Bless you. Bless you. Love you, sweetie. Love you, dear. Love you, man.
Love you, dear. How are you doing? Good.
Awesome.
Bless you.
Can I get one for Catherine?
Sure, who?
Catherine.
Catherine? Catherine who?
Grandson.
She's upstairs? Catherine? We love you. You know, the context of how Jesus said this and how Paul said, as I received from heaven, as it was delivered unto me, so I delivered unto you, as I received from the Lord. How that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, in the face of betrayal, of the ones that he brought in to be bosom friends, his own companions, the ones he was so intimate with, the ones he gave everything to, he'd look at them that night and said, every one of you are going to run away. Every one of you are going to leave me. You're not going to stand with me. But he looks far beyond our faults and failings. He looks far beyond our inabilities as human beings and sees the plan of the new creation that will spring forth and the provision that he would supply. And so he says, in the face of betrayal, he took bread and he blessed it. And after that, he gave thanks. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. The beauty of the provision of God's love made manifest to us, and that which he wants us to begin to engage in. Because people, if you'll begin to engage in loving those who don't love you, in blessing those who don't bless you, in loving those who love you with everything they know, but they're still caught away in all of the immaturity and all of the stuff that is more earthly and more worldly than it is of heaven. And we just commend this love of God, this love. We love them regardless of what they do. Hey? Instead of just writing them off, because it's so easy to write people off, it's so easy to break covenant, it's so easy to have an excuse to go away. But if you don't, if you'll just love them in the face of that, and then you will allow God to mature you as you have to work through the memory of it and the imagination and the battle of the thoughts about the way you were treated and the way you were disrespected and all the other stuff, you'll learn through the power of the Holy Ghost to make that irrelevant in your life to where it can't dominate you in your thinking and in your thoughts. And you'll find yourself maturing and growing in the supply of the Spirit and being that which God has purposed us to be in Him. He said, this is my body, which is broken for you. And we hear Isaiah, we hear the prophet saying, he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. He was chastised so that we might have peace. I see my transgressions removed. In the sacrifice of himself for me. I see my sin removed. And righteousness now here dwelling in me. I see my peace. And I also see my healing. And by his stripes, we were healed. Yes, baby. Love you, baby. It's hardest to ignore Papa for too long. Jesus.
Papa.
Yes, baby. Jesus, thank you for your body. Thank you for your broken body. Jesus, thank you that you are willing to bear in your own body my sins upon the tree. So that now, being dead to sin, I might live unto righteousness. By whose stripes I'm healed. I want you to recognize tonight, if you got any kind of sickness and disease in your body, it just departs, it has to leave. as you begin to just move in communion and fellowship with him. It's just communion. You want to get healed? Touch him. Step into fellowship and communion with him. Thank you, Jesus, for your body. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus says, my flesh is meat indeed. Let me read that. Somebody open that for me. Love you, Cade. Love you, Ruthiana. Go ahead and get with it. It was the bread of affliction, but now it's the bread of deliverance. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that all my fellowship and communion with Father is all found in what Jesus did for us, Calvary, and what we're going to do for one another in our relationship, to where there's always going to just be forgiveness, where there's always going to be just a continual connectivity and a supply of mercy and a holding of no offense and a continual honor going on. Amazing. Thank you, Jesus. And after that, they had eaten, he took the cup and he said, this is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you that your sins would be erased. For the remission, erasing of sin, the blotting out, the canceling of it. Tonight, we want you to look at the fellowship. We want you to understand the fellowship is a place of no condemnation, because all the sin has been removed. It's an opportunity to come in and be one with him because all the offense has been removed. Recognizing that the blood of Jesus Christ has washed away every stain of sin. There is no more. Can you imagine that the Lord would bring you into a place of fellowship with him to where there would be no more conscience of sin? A place of fellowship with him where there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. A place of fellowship where you recognize that he abides in you, you abide in him, where you no longer live as Christ who lives, for you to live as Christ. This is the provision of the gift of God. This here is the cup of rejoicing, dear people.
Hallelujah.
It's the cup. Jesus said, as often as you eat and drink my blood, as long as you eat and drink this communion, as you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you show my death. You show my death till I come. Lord Jesus, touch baby. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Unto him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and has made us priests and kings. Hallelujah. To be joined unto him, to be bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. That's what the communion is about. It's a different kind of communion, it's a different kind of fellowship. It's a oneness. Bone of bone and flesh of flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Thank you, Jesus. I pray that the body and the blood of Jesus Christ is means enough for you to find oneness with God. I pray in Jesus' name that the blood, that the bread and the body and the blood of Jesus Christ is means enough and proof enough for you concerning God's love and provision for you from henceforth and forevermore. I pray in the name of Jesus that the blood, this communion, this fellowship that you have with Him, of what He's done for you, will be the means by which you can now be bold about all the things that He's purposed to do with your life. Bold about the things that you desire in Him. Bold about your standing with Him. I was with some students in an orphanage one day, and I said, I was going to each one, I said, do you know, I said, are you right with God? Do you know that you've been born again? Do you know you're on your way to heaven? I said, do you know that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life? And different ones would say, God knows. Yeah, He knows, but He wants you to know. Do you know? This is our guarantee. His blood's our guarantee.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Different leaders in Israel during the days of Jesus, and they said, if you're the Christ, give us a sign. Moses did give us manna and we ate. Jesus said, Moses didn't give you the true manna. He said, I am the bread of heaven. To live every day in Him, to live every day by Him, to begin have our meditations just around this provision of His blood and of His body. Let me read this scripture to you. Real quickly, or maybe not so quickly. Luke 22, no, John chapter 6. Praise God for electronics. Listen to this. Your fathers did eat bread in the wilderness and are dead. There's a powerful verse of scripture Jesus said, and I believe it's John 8:53, he that believes in me shall not die, shall not see death. If any man believes in me, he shall not see death. Can you imagine that at the moment that you lay down and die, you will not see death, but really enter into life? Can you imagine the death of those who die in the Lord? There's nothing to fear. You won't die in the terror and the throes of death. You shall not see death. Woo! I mean, to just recognize that he that loves his brother, this is the proof that we pass from death to life. We're already in this realm of life. We've already stepped over into the realms of heaven by the Holy Ghost. By means of the broken body of Christ Jesus. The open door. We've entered in. The scripture says we've entered into the holies of holies through the veil of his flesh, through that broken body. That's the means by which we find ourselves now standing in the presence of the living God, having rights to stand there in his glory, to live in that fellowship of what Jesus did, to exalt that above everything else, all your faults, all your failings, all of your issues, all the problems, all the things. Don't let them become bigger than Jesus. This is the bread which came down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. Woo. Jesus, some pretty powerful doctrines you got going on here. I am the living bread. Which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. This fellowship of his life, where we find all of our identity, all of our existence in him, and we don't make room for any other kind of existence. Jesus said, verse 53, with absolute certainty, I tell you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoso eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. And, you know, in understanding this, you can recognize how eternal life comes. You can recognize that if we simply call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Spirit of the Lord will come upon us and create this whole new creation where we're born of the Spirit. And in that moment, we receive the very life of God, or eternal life. This is eternal life. Paul said, or forgive me, John said, we have seen that eternal life, personifying eternal life in Christ Jesus, who is manifested unto us, and we declare unto you and make known unto you. We recognize that the fellowship and the communion of the new birth, the fellowship and the communion of the new creation, the fellowship and the communion of that activity of the Holy Ghost that's now a living, a reality in our life is really connected and really in many ways the same thing as this fellowship and communion of the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, which is where we find our whole existence, our whole life. Lord, make these things so real to us. Father, make these things that once Jesus finished this sermon, everybody turned away and walked off and said, this is too hard. And he looked at the disciples and said, are you going to leave too? Because they were thinking about it. Whoso eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up in the last day. He says, for my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me, and I in him. And that is really the most salient point of understanding all that Jesus just described in eating his flesh and drinking his blood, and the communion that this represents, and the communion of the fellowship that we're supposed to have in him, to where that we see ourselves living in him and he himself living in us. Jesus says, I am the vine, you the branches. You can't. Unless you abide in me, you can't bring forth fruit. You have no life in you. Unless you abide in me, there is no life in you. And when we begin to fellowship with him on the basis of a communion, of recognizing and being really raptured by the reality that we no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives, because he's living on the inside of us. And we no longer live because we're living on the inside of him. He's in us. We abide in him. My existence is in him, and he abides in me. Coming and going, we find ourselves in him. No more other. No more distinct or different, but one. This is the fellowship. This is the communion. This is the release of a great faith in our life. Stand with me. Great abundance of his supply in our life.
Hallelujah.
This is a fellowship of love. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Father, I thank you for the moving of the Holy Ghost. I thank you for the supply of the Spirit. You just touch heaven right now for whatever it is that you have need of. Just touch heaven right now for whatever it is that you have need of. Let the Spirit of the Lord supply these things to you. Look, You're in him and he's in you. You don't have to look too far to get what he wants to supply. Come on now. You don't have to go too far to have all that he wants to give. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I commission you, listen to me. Tomorrow, you're going to come up against people. You're going to rub shoulders with people. You're going to encounter people who are in bondage to sin and death, who are under the taskmaster of the devil, whose life's wrecked with pain and sickness and disease and torment. Just go give them life. Just go bless them. Go bless them. Give them life. Say, listen, I want to bless you. Can I bless you? Who can refuse a blessing? Huh? Nobody can refuse a blessing. I said, I want to bless you. You want to do what? I want to bless you. What does that mean? It means I have the authority, the power of God in my life. I'm going to release it on you. Stop ministering to people like a scribe and a Pharisee and start speaking with one as one who has authority, as a son who has authority. Watch what God does through you. Amen. So we want you to, there's a couple of things I want to do here tonight before we go. Number one, if there's anybody in here, well, I've just served communion to everyone. We've done examined every one of you. So there's everybody in this place has given your life over to Christ Jesus. There's anybody in this place you want prayer for anything. Anything going on in your life that you know that's not the purposes of God or the will of God for your life. Any kind of sickness, disease, any kind of torment, any kind of issues, problems. You just can't seem to break through. Listen, I'll hook up with you in faith so that you can receive what God has for you. Look, but if you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost in fire, you have to participate in that agreement. I'm telling you, the miracle will be worked for you in your life. Also, we want to invite you into the miracle of divine provision that Father has for you. As you begin to worship the Lord and honor the Lord with your substance and with your tithes and with your offerings. Because Father says, he says it in this way. He says, you know, give sparingly. The Lord really doesn't even, you know, confine it, as it were in the New Testament. He says, he's like sparingly or generously. And he says, I want you to sow. And if you sow sparingly, you're going to reap sparingly, but you're still going to reap. And if you sow generously, you're going to reap generously. And here's what God is going to do. He's going to cause all grace, listen to this, all grace to abound in you. Now, everybody gets to minister as the measure of grace has been given unto you. Think about that. Romans chapter 12. I want you to contrast with me just a second. Hang with me. Take care of her. Romans chapter 12. I'm pastor, got to do everything. Romans chapter 12. You don't have to go anywhere, just hold her. Romans chapter 12. Everybody ministers out of the grace that's been given to them. Again, 2 Corinthians chapter 9. He'll make all grace, cause all grace to abound unto you, that you have all sufficiency in all things. Think about that. Consider that right now. I want you to consider that right now. I want you to consider that as something that is done. It's a given. It's a provision from heaven. Come, just bring the kids. We'll just have praying for the children. Who just went out screaming? We'll pray for these babies. Bring the child. Every language, no matter what country I go to, if a baby's crying, the baby is saying, I need the pastor to pray for me. That's what the baby's saying. Lord, touch the little guy. Look you over here now. In the name of Jesus, oh, Lord, I thank you for filling him right now with the glory of heaven. Touch his little body right now in Jesus' name. Touch mama's big old belly. Jesus' name. How many more months you got to go?
2 weeks.
Oh, 2 weeks. It looks like it. Good. And now, Lord Jesus, are you afraid?
No.
You're not good. Thank you, Jesus. Put your hand on your belly. Thank you, Jesus. Everything works easy. It called a masatera day. La satera. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Rasha teno. Roboshinaka. Roboshikanameyata. Rest your hands with Shiparanaya. Oh, Masetulo. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And we'll pray for anybody else who wants prayer. Come worship the Lord. Worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Worship the Lord with your giving. If anybody wants prayer for anything, come. We'll pray for you, and the Lord will touch you. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, tonight's the time. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost, tonight, right now, is the time. At this very moment, God will baptize you in His Holy Ghost and fire. That's the ministry of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Well, the glory of heaven's here. Hey, listen, if you're not walking around in joy divine, it's about time you find some. It's about time you hook up with heaven. Just let your hands towards heaven. Let the power of God come on you. It's about that difficult. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing.